Given that you're interested in the foundations of quantum mechanics, does causal set theory have anything to say about Bell's theorem or the inner workings of some effect that appears non-local? I also understand that there are various ways people use the term local, and thus there are various ways people can use the term non-local. So you can feel free to outline those.
Yeah, sometimes the same person will use them in different ways. One moment and then the next moment. Yes. Good. So it's my view that quantum mechanics is non-local. So the import of, what should we call them, thought experiments or thinking around situations like the EPR setup and other sort of what you might call logical antinomies that arise in quantum mechanics. The Bell's theorem and the Bell inequalities are they're subtle because I don't know quite how to think about them because they involve probabilities. And anything that involves probabilities embroils you in the question of what probability is. And yeah. Anyway, but there you don't need to think about it in order to be confronted with the conclusion or confronted with evidence that quantum mechanics is non-local. You don't need the Bell inequalities themselves. There are these other logical contradictions to classical rules of inference. So one of them is something called the GHZ setup. That's Greenberger, Horn, and Zeilinger setup where you have three spin half particles in a particular state, and you can set things up so that the prediction that you would make using classical rules of inference is exactly contradicted by what you would measure if you'd actually do the experiment. And it's a one-shot experiment rather than having to gain probabilistic information. Anyway, it's my view that quantum mechanics is non-local, but it's not non-local in space. it doesn't imply that there's superluminal influence or what Einstein referred to as spooky action at a distance. He meant spooky action at a distance in space. I don't think it doesn't imply that. It implies that there's non-local influence in time. It means that an event can influence something that happens in the future without influencing intermediate things.
Okay.
So that the influence is not local in space-time. It's non-local in space-time, but it's still causal. So the effect of the cause is still within the future light cone of the cause. So it's not acausal. It doesn't violate relativistic causality, which says that causes can only affect things at or less than the speed of light. That's still the case. So, but the influence doesn't propagate locally in space-time, but jumps, if you like.
Okay. And it can only jump to the future.
Yeah, and it can only jump to the future.
And is there a limit to how far it can jump?
No.
Okay. And is that necessary? So in other words, when something is non-local, is it necessarily infinitely non-local? Like, is there a degree of measurement to non-locality, or is it zero or one? Like, it's all the way or none?
I suppose we don't really know fully because we don't have our theory of quantum gravity. But if one takes the lessons of quantum theory as we know it and causal set theory, which is a non-local theory, then there is no limit to how far into the future the effects of a cause can manifest itself. So I would hazard that, yeah, it has to be finite, but arbitrarily far into the future.
I see. This word quantum theory comes up over and over, and it would be great to just define, when someone hands you a theory, how do you know if it's a quantum theory? Like, what are the necessary and sufficient conditions if there's a consensus on that? Is it H-bar, you have it, or is it just non-commuting observables? Like, what is it that makes a theory a quantum theory?
Mm. So in the path integral, from the path integral perspective, you can think of the path integral quantum mechanics as a species of a more general type of theory called a measure theory. So in a measure theory, there are events, things that can happen, and then there's some measure on those events. In a classical theory, that measure would be a probability measure. So each event has some probability of it happening. And in a quantum theory, there is again a measure for each event, but that measure is no longer a probability, or not necessarily, it's a probability. What it actually is, well, that's the whole, then, you know, welcome to our world of trying to figure out what it actually is, or what it means, or how to interpret it. But it's a measure that when you calculate it, you can see there's interference between histories. So the probability of an event in a classical theory is just, you just add up the probabilities of all the histories in that event. So all the possible ways that that event can happen, you add up the probabilities of all those ways, and that's the probability that the event happens. In quantum theory, roughly speaking, you take all the histories that make up that event, and then each one has an amplitude, not a probability. You add up those amplitudes and you square it, or you take the mod squared, roughly speaking. So it's that squaring which is the quantum. That's where you see the quantumness, because that's what gives you interference, it gives you the signature of quantum mechanics, which is, say, the fringe patterns of the double slit experiment. So yeah, it's interference between histories when you calculate the measure of an event. That's quantumness for me.
Yes, I see. Was there some landmark result that came from causal set theory that convinced you, wow, we're on the right track? So for instance, there's something about Hawking radiation, or the entropy of a black hole, or anything that has discreteness solves some of the problems with the path integral, because you don't go all the way down to zero, so you don't get these UV divergences. So that's a win, but there are other discrete approaches to physics as well, so it's not a unique win, which we'll also get to causal dynamical triangulations later. But the point is that what was along your journey in studying causal set theory and developing it, what was some result that led you to feel, okay, man, this is super cool, we're on the right track?
A few things, but one that's particularly nice or fun to recount is the discovery of the accelerated expansion of the cosmos. So that was when the measurements of distant supernovae and their luminosities showed that the universe, the equation of motion of the expansion rate of the universe had to be modified by adding what is known by various monikers. One is dark energy, another is the cosmological constant. So you have to add a fudge factor to the so-called Friedmann equation for the expansion of the universe in order to account for these supernovae results. And that was, you know, it's nice, you can go onto the Nobel Prize website and there's little clips of the three people who won the Nobel Prize for that discovery, and they all say they thought it was preposterous, and they all delayed releasing their results because they thought they must have made a mistake. They all said that, all of them. They said, oh, it's clearly a mistake. We better go back and check. It'll go away. Of course, it didn't go away. And then they won the Nobel Prize. So,
right.
So that fudge factor is real. I mean, that's, you need it in order to, you need to add that to the equation. And it's a mystery what it is. That's a puzzle of dark energy. But what was nice for us working on causal set theory was that Raphael Sorkin had, he had predicted that this effect should be there, that there should be this accelerated expansion, and he predicted the order of magnitude using basic ideas from causal set theory, basic expectations of what a quantum theory of causal set theory will look like. And it's kind of a back of the envelope calculation. It's a heuristic calculation. It's not something we can, because we don't have a quantum theory of causal sets, we can't rigorously show that or derive this result. But it's so sweet, and it's, and when you make a prediction in advance of the measurement of the observation, and at a time when no one wanted it or expected it, or, you know, everyone simply assumed that the cosmological constant was zero, and it was only gradually that certain cosmologists were starting to say, well, actually, our cold dark matter cosmological model is not really fitting the data anymore. We might need to add a bit of lambda, a bit of cosmological constant, just from to fit cosmological data. That started before the supernovae results, but Raphael's prediction was even before that. So we were getting excited because the cosmologists were starting to say, maybe we need this cosmological constant. No, it was, yeah, not too many people were taking that up, but it was starting to happen. It reminds me a little bit now of the situation with the Hubble tension.
Yes, how so?
Well, it at first, of course, you know, at first it was sort of a mild tension. Now people are saying that it's a tension at the level of five or more sigma. So it's a real, you know, it's a real.
There was something that was just released on that, like within a week ago, about how with the new James Webb telescope data, some other research team has found that the tension disappears. I haven't looked into it, but it's within a week that this came out.
I better look that up. I like tension.
Yeah, exactly.
I hope it doesn't go away.
Anomalies are interesting.
Yeah, this new, that's something to understand. Yeah.
So when Raphael did that calculation, did he have to put in any matter?
No, it doesn't. Well, there is matter in the model. I mean, in the cosmological model, there's the usual matter. But what Raphael's model and idea cleverly does, it means that the cosmological term, the cosmological constant is not a constant, just like the Hubble constant is not a constant. So it's a parameter so lambda varies, it's not a constant. In fact, it fluctuates. It fluctuates throughout cosmic history between positive and negative values. But the envelope of the fluctuations always tracks the ambient matter density. So sometimes people call these tracker models. So in that sense, it solves this why now problem. So the why now problem is why is lambda, that is dark energy, why is it starting to dominate the universe now? So the transition between matter domination and lambda domination is happening now. Why is that? Is that, you know, that's a tuning problem, if you like, for the cosmological model. So the lambda has to be just so that it's just coming to dominate now. But in Raphael's conception, it's always true. So that another phrase that his he and his collaborators coined for this model is ever-present lambda. So it's always the case that the expected value of lambda is of order the plus or minus the ambient matter density. Anyway, that was, it's very hard to express just how powerful or influential on one's thinking that experience of having a prediction in advance of the actual observation is. It's, yeah.
Wonderful.
So instead of saying, well, there's this data we need to explain, let's go make our model explain it, you predict something unexpected.
Yeah, like a retrodiction.
Right.
Yeah, you've done a prediction. Got it. Yes.
Yeah, genuine prediction. Mm.
If you enjoyed this Toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 Toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.